All right, this is just a quick little video to show you who William Branham's first pastor was. William Branham's first pastor was actually a leader of the Ku Klux Klan. And I have also a short little video clip that will have William Branham himself being very sympathetic towards the Klan as well. Now, this is The Voice of Healing. This is on page 14. You can see right up here at the date. It's October 1950. And this is an article in it called William Branham's First Pastor. And his name was Reverend Roy E. Davis, Sr. I'm just going to read just a little bit of the article for you. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but it says, "Dear Brother Lindsay, for some few months I have been impressed to write an article of Billy Branham. After meditation and prayer, I have decided to do so. I hope I can compose this article in such a manner that I will see it in print. First, I am the minister who received Brother Branham into the first Pentecostal assembly he ever frequented. I baptized him and was his pastor for some 2 years. I also preached his ordination sermon and signed his ordination certificate and heard him preach his first sermon. I was the first man on this earth whom Billy ever saw anointed and pray for a sick person. I feel I can write more intimately of Billy Branham than any living minister, as he also received his baptism of the Holy Ghost in my humble home in Jefferson, Indiana." So this is him right here, Roy E. Davis, Sr. Good picture of him right there. Now we're going to go over here to newspapers.com, and we're going to look at the date here. The Times, Shreveport, Louisiana, April 7th, 1961. Now, he was involved with the Klan well before the 60s. He was involved with the Klan even before he had ordained William Branham. Klan leader picked up, warned by police here. "The self-styled leader of the Ku Klux Klan was arrested here yesterday and questioned for 2 hours about his local activities and Shreveport cross burnings. During the extensive questioning, he was strongly criticized by Police Chief Harvey D. Teasley. The Klan official," there it is, "R. E. Davis of Dallas, was arrested at 4:45 p.m. He was returning home after a 2-day visit of, I guess that's Bossier, I'm not sure, city. During much of this time, he was under surveillance by law officers and Shreveport Time newsmen. Captain Coles Thomas arrested the Texas man of the in the 1,000 block of Texas. Davis told Teasley that the charter of the local KKK chapter has been revoked. He said he took the charter away from the local group because he became suspicious that some of its members were involved in the cross burning in front of the U.S. Congressman Overton Brooks home in February. Teasley denounced both Davis personally and the Cladstein group that Davis purports to head as Imperial Grand Wizard, and he warned the man that Shreveport does not need this subversive organization. So anyway, I just wanted to show you that. Now I'm going to show you a clip, and you can hear Branham himself being very sympathetic to this organization.
"I was out hunting one time, which seems to be a second nature to me, to love to hunt. And I was out hunting with a boy, Jim Poole. Lovely kid. I think his boy comes to church here, little Jim, and fine family of people. I know the Pooles. Jimmy and I slept together and lived together since we were little boys in school. We're about 6 months apart in age. And Jimmy let his gun go off and shot me through both legs, real close to me, the shotgun. I was taken to the hospital, and they're laying there dying, no penicillin or nothing in those days. And they had a rubber sheet under me, and I know that night they was going to operate the next morning. They just took and cleaned off the wound, and big pieces of flesh blowed up, and they take scissors and cut it off, and I had to hold a man's hands, and they had Frankie Ike, who just recently committed suicide. And I had to hold and pry my hands loose from his wrist when they got through. I screamed and cried and holding on to like that, and then cutting that part of the leg off. I was 14 years old, just a boy. And that night, I tried to go to sleep, and I woke up, something splashed. And here was blood, nearly a half a gallon, I guess, had come from them veins. And they'd taken an x-ray, and they said the shot was laying so close to that artery on either side that just a little scratch would cut it right in two, and I started bleeding. Well, I thought, this is the end of me. And I put my hands down like this and raised it up, blood running down my hands. It was my own blood I was laying in. I called, rang the bell, the nurse came, and she just soaked it up with towel because there's nothing they could do. And the next morning, under those weakening conditions, they didn't give the blood transfusion in them days, you know, so they operated on me. And they gave me ether. And when the old ether, I guess you remember, it's the old anesthetic. And under that ether, when I came out, I was coming out of the ether after 8 hours. They had to give me so much they thought I wouldn't wake up. They couldn't get me awake. I remember Mrs. Roeder stood by me out there in the hospital. I'll never forget that woman. No matter whatever happens, I can never forget her. She's just a young woman, and her husband was superintendent down here at the car works. And I remember she standing by me, her and Mrs. Stewart. And they was the one actually that paid my hospital bill. We didn't even have food to eat in the house, so how could we pay a hospital bill of hundreds of dollars? But she, through her church society and the Ku Klux Klan, paid the hospital bill for me. Masons. I can never forget them. No matter what they do or what, I still, there's something that stays with me. See, what they did for me. Ku Klux Klan paid the hospital bill for me. Masons. I can never forget them. No matter what they do or what, I still, there's something that stays with me. See, what they did for me. And they paid the bill to Dr. Reeder. Ku Klux Klan paid the hospital bill for me. Ku Klux Klan paid the hospital bill for me. Masons. I can never forget them.